Homilies and Recognitions by Bishop Clement. Continues. Homilies. Book 3. Continues. Chapter 29. The Signal Given. While Peter was about to explain fully to us this mystic word, Zacchaeus came, saying, "Now indeed, O Peter, is the time for you to go out and engage in the discussion, for a great crowd awaits you, packed together in the court, and in the midst of them stands Simon, like a war chieftain attended by his spearmen." And Peter, hearing this, ordered me to withdraw for prayer, as not yet having received baptism for salvation, and then said to those who were already perfected, "Let us rise and pray that God, by his unfailing mercies, may help me striving for the salvation of the men whom he has made." And having thus said, and having prayed, he went out into the uncovered portion of the court, which was a large space, and there were many come together for the purpose of seeing him, his preeminence having made them more eagerly hasten to hear. Chapter 30. Apostolic Salutation. Therefore, standing and seeing all the people gazing upon him in profound silence, and Simon the magician standing in the midst, he began to speak thus, "Peace be to all you who are in readiness to give your right hands to the truth of God, which, being his great and incomparable gift in the present world, he who sent us, being an infallible prophet of that which is supremely profitable, gave us in charge, by way of salutation before our words of instruction, to announce to you, in order that, if there be any son of peace among you, peace may take hold of him through our teaching, but if any of you will not receive it, then we, shaking off for a testimony the way dust of our feet, which we have borne through our toils, and brought to you that you may be saved, will go to the abodes and the cities of others." Chapter 31. Faith in God. And we tell you truly, it shall be more tolerable in the day of judgment to dwell in the land of Sodom and Gomorrah, than in the place of unbelief. In the first place, because you have not preserved of yourselves what is reasonable, in the second place, because, hearing the things concerning us, you have not come to us, and in the third place, because you have disbelieved us when we have come to you. Wherefore, being concerned for you, we pray of our own accord that our peace may come upon you. If therefore ye will have it, you must readily promise not to do injustice, and generously to bear wrong, which the nature of man would not sustain, unless it first received the knowledge of that which is supremely profitable, which is to know the righteous nature of him who is over all, that he defends and avenges those who are wronged, and does good forever to the pious. Chapter 32. Invitation. Do you, therefore, as thankful servants of God, perceiving of yourselves what is reasonable, take upon you the manner of life that is pleasing to him, that so, loving him, and being loved of him, you may enjoy good forever. For to him alone is it most possible to bestow it, who gave being to things that were not, who created the heavens, settled the earth, set bounds to the sea, stored up the things that are in Hades, and filled all places with air. Chapter 33. Works of Creation. He alone turned into the four contrary elements the one, first, simple substance. Thus combining them, he made of them myriads of compounds, that, being turned into opposite natures, and mingled, they might affect the pleasure of life from the combination of contraries. In like manner, he alone, having created races of angels and spirits by the fiat of his will, peopled the heavens, as also he decked the visible firmament with stars, to which also he assigned their paths and arranged their courses. He compacted the earth for the production of fruits. He set bounds to the sea, marking out a dwelling place on the dry land. He stores up the things in Hades, designating it as the place of souls, and he filled all places with air, that all living creatures might be able to breathe safely in order that they might live. Chapter 34. Extent of Creation. O the great hand of the wise God, which doth all in all. For a countless multitude of birds have been made by him, and those various, differing in all respects from one another, I mean in respect of their colors, beaks, talons, looks, senses, voices, and all else. And how many different species of plants, distinguished by boundless variety of colors, qualities, and scents. And how many animals on the land and in the water, of which it were impossible to tell the figures, forms, habitats, color, food, senses, natures, multitude. Then also the multitude and height of mountains, the varieties of stones, awful caverns, fountains, rivers, marshes, seas, harbors, islands, forests, and all the inhabited world, and places uninhabited. Chapter 35. These are a part of his ways. And how many things besides are unknown, having eluded the sagacity of men. And of those that are within our comprehension, who of mankind knows the limit? I mean, how the heaven rolls, how the stars are born in their courses, and what forms they have, and the subsistence of their being, and what are their ethereal paths. And whence the blasts of winds are borne around, and have different energies, whence the fountains ceaselessly spring, and the rivers, being ever flowing, run down into the sea, and neither is that fountain emptied whence they come, nor do they fill that sea whither they come. How far reaches the unfathomable depth of the boundless Tartarus? Upon what the heaven is upborne which encircles all? How the clouds spring from air, and are absorbed into air? What is the nature of thunder and lightning, snow, hail, mist, ice, storms, showers, hanging clouds? And how he makes plants and animals? And these things, with all accuracy, continually perfected in their countless varieties. Chapter 36. Dominion over the creatures. Therefore, if anyone shall accurately scan the whole with reason, he shall find that God has made them for the sake of man. For showers fall for the sake of fruits, that man may partake of them, and that animals may be fed, that they may be useful to men. And the sun shines, that he may turn the air into four seasons, and that each time may afford its peculiar service to man. And the fountains spring, that drink may be given to men. And, moreover, who is Lord over the creatures, so far as is possible? Is it not man, who has received wisdom to till the earth, to sail the sea, to make fishes, birds, and beasts his prey, to investigate the course of the stars, to mine the earth, to sail the sea, to build cities, to define kingdoms, to ordain laws, to execute justice, to know the invisible God, to be cognizant of the names of angels, to drive away demons, to endeavor to cure diseases by medicines, to find charms against poison darting serpents, to understand antipathies. Chapter 37. Whom to know is life eternal. But if thou art thankful, O man, understanding that God is thy benefactor in all things, thou mayest even be immortal, the things that are made for thee having continuance through thy gratitude. And now thou art able to become incorruptible, if thou acknowledge him whom thou didst not know, if thou love him whom thou didst forsake, if thou pray to him alone who is able to punish or to save thy booty and soul. Wherefore, before all things, consider that no one shares his rule, no one has a name in common with him, that is called God. For he alone is both called and is God. Nor is it lawful to think that there is any other, or to call any other by that name. And if anyone should dare do so, eternal punishment of soul is his. Chapter 38. Simon's challenge. When Peter had thus spoken, Simon, at the outside of the crowd, cried aloud, "Why would you lie, and deceive the unlearned multitude standing around you, persuading them that it is unlawful to think that there are gods, and to call them so, when the books that are current among the Jews say that there are many gods? And now I wish, in the presence of all, to discuss with you from these books on the necessity of thinking that there are gods, first showing respecting him whom you call God, that he is not the supreme and omnipotent being, inasmuch as he is without foreknowledge, imperfect, needy, not good, and underlying many and innumerable grievous passions. Wherefore, when this has been shown from the scriptures, as I say, it follows that there is another, not written of, foreknowing, perfect, without want, good, removed froth all grievous passions. But he whom you call the Creator is subject to the opposite evils. Chapter 39. defects ascribed to God. Therefore also Adam, being made at first after his likeness, is created blind, and is said not to have knowledge of good or evil, and is found a transgressor, and is driven out of paradise, and is punished with death. In like manner also, he who made him, because he sees not in all places, says with reference to the overthrow of Sodom, "Come, and let us go down, and see whether they do according to their cry which comes to me, or if not, that I may know." Thus he shows himself ignorant and in his saying respecting Adam, "Let us drive him out, lest he put forth his hand and touch the tree of life, and eat, and live forever," in saying, lest he is ignorant, and in driving him out lest he should eat and live forever, he is also envious. And whereas it is written that God repented that he had made man, this implies both repentance and ignorance. For this reflection is a view by which one, through ignorance, wishes to inquire into the result of the things which he wills, or it is the act of one repenting on account of the event not being according to his expectation. And whereas it is written, "And the Lord smelled a scent of sweetness," it is the part of one in need, and his being pleased with the fat of flesh is the part of one who is not good. But his tempting, as it is written, "And God did tempt Abraham," is the part of one who is wicked, and who is ignorant of the issue of the experiment. Chapter 40. Peter's answer. In like manner Simon, by taking many passages from the Scriptures, seemed to show that God is subject to every infirmity. And to this Peter said, "Does he who is evil, and wholly wicked, love to accuse himself in the things in which he sins? Answer me this." Then said Simon, "He does not." Then said Peter, "How, then, can God be evil and wicked, seeing that those evil things which have been commonly written regarding him, have been added by his own will?" Then said Simon, "It may be that the charge against him is written by another power, and not according to his choice." Then said Peter, "Let us then, in the first place, inquire into this. If, indeed, he has of his own will accused himself, as you formerly acknowledged, then he is not wicked, but if it is done by another power, it must be inquired and investigated with all energy who hath subjected to all evils him who alone is good." Chapter 41. Status quaestiones. Then said Simon, "You are manifestly avoiding the hearing of the charge from the Scriptures against your God." Then Peter, "You yourself appear to me to be doing this, for he who avoids the order of inquiry, does not wish a true investigation to be made. Hence I, who proceed in an orderly manner, and wish that the writer should first be considered, am manifestly desirous to walk in a straight path." Then Simon, "First confess that if the things written against the Creator are true, he is not above all, since, according to the Scriptures, he is subject to all evil, then afterwards we shall inquire as to the writer." Then said Peter, "That I may not seem to speak against your want of order through unwillingness to enter upon the investigation, I answer you. I say that if the things written against God are true, they do not show that God is wicked." Then said Simon, "How can you maintain that?" Chapter 42. Was Adam blind? Then said Peter, "Because things are written opposite to those sayings which speak evil of him, wherefore neither the one nor the other can be confirmed." Then Simon, "How, then, is the truth to be ascertained, of those Scriptures that say he is evil, or of those that say he is good?" Then Peter, "Whatever sayings of the Scriptures are in harmony with the creation that was made by him are true, but whatever are contrary to it are false." Then Simon said, "How can you show that the Scriptures contradict themselves?" And Peter said, "You say that Adam was created blind, which was not so, for he would not have pointed out the tree of the knowledge of good and evil to a blind man, and commanded him not to taste of it." Then said Simon, "He meant that his mind was blind." Then Peter, "How could he be blind in respect of his mind, who, before tasting of the tree, in harmony with him who made him, imposed appropriate names on all the animals?" Then Simon, "If Adam had foreknowledge, how did he not foreknow that the serpent would deceive his wife?" Then Peter, "If Adam had not foreknowledge, How did he give names to the sons of men as they were born with reference to their future doings, calling the first Cain possession, who through possession killed his brother Abel vapor, for his parents grieved over him, the first slain? Chapter 43. God's foreknowledge. But if Adam, being the work of God, had foreknowledge, much more the God who created him. And that is false which is written that God reflected, as if using reasoning on account of ignorance, and that the Lord tempted Abraham, that he might know if he would endure it, and that which is written, Let us go down, and see if they are doing according to the cry of them which cometh to me, and if not, that I may know. And, not to extend my discourse too far, whatever sayings ascribe ignorance to him, or anything else that is evil, being upset by other sayings which affirm the contrary, are proved to be false. But because he does indeed foreknow, he says to Abraham, Thou shalt assuredly know that thy seed shall be sojourners in a land that is not their own, and they shall enslave them, and shall evil entreat them, and humble them 400 years. But the nation to which they shall be in bondage will I judge, and after that they shall come out hither with much property, but thou shalt depart to thy fathers with peace, being nourished in a good old age, and in the fourth generation they shall return hither, for the sins of the Amorites are hitherto not filled up. Chapter 44. God's decrees. But what? Does not Moses pre-intimate the sins of the people, and predict their dispersion among the nations? But if he gave foreknowledge to Moses, how can it be that he had it not himself? But he has it. And if he has it, as we have also shown, it is an extravagant saying that he reflected, and that he repented, and that he went down to see, and whatever else of this sort. Whatsoever things being foreknown before they come to pass as about to befall, take issue by a wise economy, without repentance. Chapter 45. Sacrifices. But that he is not pleased with sacrifices, is shown by this, that those who lusted after flesh were slain as soon as they tasted it, and were consigned to a tomb, so that it was called the grave of lusts. He then who at the first was displeased with the slaughtering of animals, not wishing them to be slain, did not ordain sacrifices as desiring them, nor from the beginning did he require them. For neither are sacrifices accomplished without the slaughter of animals, nor can the first fruits be presented. But how is it possible for him to abide in darkness and smoke and storm, who created a pure heaven, and created the sun to give light to all, and assigned the invariable order of their revolutions to innumerable stars? Thus, O Simon, the handwriting of God, I mean the heaven, shows the counsels of him who made it to be pure and stable. Chapter 46. Disparagements of God. Thus the sayings accusatory of the God who made the heaven are both rendered void by the opposite sayings which are alongside of them, and are refuted by the creation. For they were not written by a prophetic hand. Wherefore also they appear opposite to the hand of God, who made all things. Then said Simon, How can you show this? Chapter 47. Foreknowledge of Moses. Then said Peter, The law of God was given by Moses, without writing, to 70 wise men, to be handed down, that the government might be carried on by succession. But after that Moses was taken up, it was written by someone, but not by Moses. For in the law itself it is written, And Moses died, and they buried him near the house of Phagor, and no one knows his sepulchre till this day. But how could Moses write that Moses died? And whereas in the time after Moses, about 500 years or thereabouts, it is found lying in the temple which was built, and after about 500 years more it is carried away, and being burnt in the time of Nebuchadnezzar it is destroyed, and thus being written after Moses, and often lost, even this shows the foreknowledge of Moses, because he, foreseeing its disappearance, did not write it, but those who wrote it, being convicted of ignorance through their not foreseeing its disappearance, were not prophets. Chapter 48. Test of Truth. Then said Simon, Since, as you say, we must understand the things concerning God by comparing them with the creation, how is it possible to recognize the other things in the law which are from the tradition of Moses, and are true, and are mixed up with these falsehoods. Then Peter said, a certain verse has been recorded without controversy in the written law, according to the providence of God, so as to show clearly which of the things written are true and which are false. Then said Simon, which is that? Show it us. Chapter 49. The True Prophet. Then Peter said, I shall tell you forthwith. It is written in the first book of the law, towards the end, a ruler shall not fail from Judah, nor a leader from his thighs, until he come whose it is, and he is the expectation of the nations. If, therefore, anyone can apprehend him who came after the failure of ruler and leader from Judah, and who was to be expected by the nations, he will be able by this verse to recognize him as truly having come, and believing his teaching, he will know what of the scriptures are true and what are false. Then said Simon, I understand that you speak of your Jesus as him who was prophesied of by the scripture. Therefore let it be granted that it is so. Tell us, then, how he taught you to discern the scriptures. Chapter 50. His teaching concerning the scriptures. Then Peter, as to the mixture of truth with falsehood, I remember that on one occasion he, finding fault with the Sadducees, said, Wherefore ye do err, not knowing the true things of the scriptures, and on this account ye are ignorant of the power of God. But if he cast up to there that they knew not the true things of the scriptures, it is manifest that there are false things in them. And also, inasmuch as he said, Be ye prudent money changers, it is because there are genuine and spurious words. And whereas he said, Wherefore do ye not perceive that which is reasonable in the scriptures? He makes the understanding of him stronger who voluntarily judges soundly. Chapter 51. His teaching concerning the law. And his sending to the scribes and teachers of the existing scriptures, as to those who knew the true things of the law that then was, is well known. And also that he said, I am not come to destroy the law, and yet that he appeared to be destroying it, is the part of one intimating that the things which he destroyed did not belong to the law. And his saying, The heaven and the earth shall pass away, but one jot or one tittle shall not pass froth the law, intimated that the things which pass away before the heaven and the earth do not belong to the law in reality. Chapter 52. Other sayings of Christ. Since, then, while the heaven and the earth still stand, sacrifices have passed away, and kingdoms, and prophecies among those who are born of woman, and such like, as not being ordinances of God, hence therefore he says, Every plant which the heavenly Father has not planted shall be rooted up. Wherefore he, being the true prophet, said, I am the gate of life, he who entereth through me entereth into life, there being no other teaching able to save. Wherefore also he cried, and said, Come unto me, all who labor, that is, who are seeking the truth, and not finding it, and again, My sheep hear my voice, and elsewhere, seek and find, since the truth does not lie on the surface. Chapter 53. Other sayings of Christ. But also a witnessing voice was heard from heaven, saying, This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased, hear him. And in addition to this, willing to convict more fully of error the prophets from whom they asserted that they had learned, he proclaimed that they died desiring the truth, but not having learned it, saying, Many prophets and kings desired to see what ye see, and to hear what you hear, and verily I say to you, they neither saw nor heard. Still further he said, I am he concerning whom Moses prophesied, saying, A prophet shall the Lord our God raise unto you of your brethren, like unto me, him hear in all things, and whosoever will not hear that prophet shall die. Chapter 54. Other sayings. Whence it is impossible without his teaching to attain to saving truth, though one seek it forever where the thing that is sought is not. But it was, and is, in the word of our Jesus. Accordingly, he, knowing the true things of the law, said to the Sadducees, asking on what account Moses permitted to marry seven, Moses gave you commandments according to your hard-heartedness, for from the beginning it was not so, for he who created man at first, made him male and female. Chapter 55. Teaching of Christ. But to those who think, As the scriptures teach, that God swears, he said, let your yea be yea, and nay, nay, for what is more than these is of the evil one. And to those who say that Abraham and Isaac and Jacob are dead, he said, God is not of the dead, but of the living. And to those who suppose that God tempts, as the scriptures say, he said, the tempter is the wicked one, who also tempted himself. To those who suppose that God does not foreknow, he said, for your heavenly Father knoweth that ye need all these things before ye ask him. And to those who believe, as the scriptures say, that he does not see all things, he said, pray in secret, and your Father, who seeth secret things, will reward you. Chapter 56. Teaching of Christ. And to those who think that he is not good, as the scriptures say, he said, from which of you shall his son ask bread, and he will give him a stone, or shall ask a fish, and he will give him a serpent? If ye then, being evil, know to give good gifts to your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give good things to those who ask him, and to those who do his will? But to those who affirmed that he was in the temple, he said, swear not by heaven, for it is God's throne, nor by the earth, for it is the footstool of his feet. And to those who supposed that God is pleased with sacrifices, he said, God wishes mercy, and not sacrifices, the knowledge of himself, and not holocausts. Chapter 57. Teaching of Christ. But to those who are persuaded that he is evil, as the scriptures say, he said, call not me good, for one only is good. And again, be ye good and merciful, as your Father in the heavens, who makes the sun rise on good and evil men, and brings rain upon just and unjust. But to those who were misled to imagine many gods, as the scriptures say, he said, hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is one Lord. Chapter 58. Flight of Simon. Therefore Simon, perceiving that Peter was driving him to use the scriptures as Jesus taught, was unwilling that the discussion should go into the doctrine concerning God, even although Peter had changed the discussion into question and answer, as Simon himself asked. However, the discussion occupied 3 days. And while the fourth was dawning, he set off darkling as far as Tyre of Phoenicia. And not many days after, some of the precursors came and said to Peter, Simon is doing great miracles in Tyre, and disturbing many of the people there, and by many slanders he has made you to be hated. Chapter 59. Peter's resolution to follow. Peter, hearing this, on the following night assembled the multitude of hearers, and as soon as they were come together, he said, while I am going forth to the nations which say that there are many gods, to teach and to preach that God is one, who made heaven and earth, and all things that are in them, in order that they may love him and be saved, evil has anticipated me, and by the very law of conjunction has sent Simon before me, in order that these men, if they shall cease to say that there are many gods, disowning those upon earth that are called gods, may think that there are many gods in heaven, so that, not feeling the excellency of the monarchy, they may perish with eternal punishment. And what is most dreadful, since true doctrine has incomparable power, he forestalls me with slanders, and persuades them to this, not even at first to receive me, lest he who is the slanderer be convicted of being himself in reality a devil, and the true doctrine be received and believed. Therefore I must quickly catch him up, lest the false accusation, through gaining time, wholly get hold of all men. Chapter 60. Successor to be appointed. Since, therefore, it is necessary to set apart someone instead of me to fill my place, let us all with one consent pray to God, that he would make manifest who amongst us is the best, that, sitting in the chair of Christ, he may piously rule his church. Who, then, shall be set apart? For by the counsel of God that man is set forth as blessed, whom his Lord shall appoint over the ministry of his fellow servants, to give them their meat in their season, not thinking and saying in his heart, my Lord delayeth his coming, and who shall not begin to beat his fellow servants, eating and drinking with harlots and drunkards. And the Lord of that servant shall come in an hour when he doth not look for him, and in a day when he is not aware, and shall cut him in sunder, and shall assign his unfaithful part with the hypocrites. Chapter 61. Monarchy. But if any one of those present, being able to instruct the ignorance of men, shrink from it, thinking only of his own ease, let him expect to hear the sentence, O wicked and slothful servant, thou oughtest to have given my money to the exchangers, and I at my coming should have got my own. Cast out the unprofitable servant into the outer darkness. And with good reason, for, says he, it is thine, O man, to prove my words, as silver and money are proved among the exchangers. Therefore the multitude of the faithful ought to obey someone, that they may live in harmony. For that which tends to the government of one person, in the form of monarchy, enables the subjects to enjoy peace by means of good order, but in case of all, through desire of ruling, being unwilling to submit to one only, they must altogether fall by reason of division. Chapter 62. Obedience leads to peace. But, further, let the things that are happening before your eyes persuade you, how wars are constantly arising through there being now many kings all over the earth. For each one holds the government of another as a pretext for war. But if one were universal superior, he, having no reason why he should make war, would have perpetual peace. In short, therefore, to those who are thought worthy of eternal life, God appoints one universal king in the world that shall then be, that by means of monarchy there may be unfailing peace. It behooves all, therefore, to follow someone as a leader, honoring him as the image of God, and it behooves the leader to be acquainted with the road that entereth into the holy city. Chapter 63. Zacchaeus appointed. But of those who are present, whom shall I choose but Zacchaeus, to whom also the Lord went in and rested, judging him worthy to be saved? And having said this, he laid his hand upon Zacchaeus, who stood by, and forced him to sit down in his own chair. But Zacchaeus, falling at his feet, begged that he would permit him to decline the rulership, promising, at the same time, and saying, Whatever it behooves the ruler to do, I will do, only grant me not to have this name, for I am afraid of assuming the name of the rulership, for it teems with bitter envy and danger. Chapter 64. The Bishop. Then Peter said, If you are afraid of this, do not be called ruler, but the appointed one, the Lord having permitted you to be so called, when he said, Blessed is that man whom his Lord shall appoint to the ministry of his fellow servants. But if you wish it to be altogether unknown that you have authority of administration, you seem to me to be ignorant that the acknowledged authority of the president has great influence as regards the respect of the multitude. For every one obeys him who has received authority, having conscience as a great constraint. And are you not well aware that you are not to rule as the rulers of the nations, but as a servant ministering to them, as a father to the oppressed, visiting them as a physician, guarding them as a shepherd, in short, taking all care for their salvation? And do you think that I am not aware what labors I compel you to undertake, desiring you to be judged by multitudes whom it is impossible for anyone to please? But it is most possible for him who does well to please God. Wherefore I entreat you to undertake it heartily, by God, by Christ, for the salvation of the brethren, for their ordering, and your own profit. Chapter 65. Nolo Episcopari. And consider this other thing, that in proportion as there is labor and danger in ruling the Church of Christ, so much greater is the reward. And yet again the greater is also the punishment to him who can, and refuses. I wish, therefore, knowing that you are the best instructed of my attendants, to turn to account those noble powers of judging with which you have been entrusted by the Lord, in order that you may be saluted with the well done, good and faithful servant, and not be found fault with, and declared liable to punishment, like him who hid the one talent. But if you will not be appointed a good guardian of the church, point out another in your stead, more learned and more faithful than yourself. But you cannot do this, for you associated with the Lord, and witnessed his marvelous doings, and learned the administration of the church. Chapter 66. Danger of disobedience. and your work is to order what things are proper, and that of the brethren is to submit, and not to disobey. Therefore submitting they shall be saved, but disobeying they shall be punished by the Lord, because the president is entrusted with the place of Christ. Wherefore, indeed, honor or contempt shown to the president is handed on to Christ, and from Christ to God. And this I have said, that these brethren may not be ignorant of the danger they incur by disobedience to you, because whosoever disobeys your orders, disobeys Christ, and he who disobeys Christ offends God. Chapter 67. Duties of Church Office Bearers. It is necessary, therefore, that the church, as a city built upon a hill, have an order approved of God, and good government. In particular, let the bishop, as chief, be heard in the things which he speaks, and let the elders give heed that the things ordered be done. Let the deacons, going about, look after the bodies and the souls of the brethren, and report to the bishop. Let all the rest of the brethren bear wrong patiently, but if they wish judgment to be given concerning wrongs done to them, let them be reconciled in presence of the elders, and let the elders report the reconciliation to the bishop. Chapter 68. Marriage always honorable. And let them inculcate marriage not only upon the young, but also upon those advanced in years, lest burning lust bring a plague upon the church by reason of whoredom or adultery. For, above every other sin, the wickedness of adultery is hated by God, because it not only destroys the person himself who sins, but those also who eat and associate with him. For it is like the madness of a dog, because it has the nature of communicating its own madness. For the sake of chastity, therefore, let not only the elders, but even all, hasten to accomplish marriage. For the sin of him who commits adultery necessarily comes upon all. Therefore, to urge the brethren to be chaste, this is the first charity. For it is the healing of the soul. For the nourishment of the body is rest. Chapter 69. Not forsaking the assembling of yourselves together. But if you love your brethren, take nothing from them, but share with them such things as ye have. Feed the hungry, give drink to the thirsty, clothe the naked, visit the sick, so far as you can, help those in prison, receive strangers gladly into your own abodes, hate no one. And how you must be pious, your own mind will teach you, judging rightly. But before all else, if indeed I need say it to you, come together frequently, if it were every hour, especially on the appointed days of meeting. For if you do this, you are within a wall of safety. For disorderliness is the beginning of perdition. Let no one therefore forsake the assembly on the ground of envy towards a brother. For if any one of you forsake the assembly, he shall be regarded as of those who scatter the church of Christ, and shall be cast out with adulterers. For as an adulterer, under the influence of the spirit that is in him, he separates himself on some pretext, and gives place to the wicked one against himself, a sheep for the stealing, as one found outside the fold. Chapter 70. Hear the bishop. However, hear your bishop, and do not weary of giving all honor to him, knowing that, by showing it to him, it is born to Christ, and from Christ it is born to God, and to him who offers it, is requited manifold. Honor, therefore, the throne of Christ. For you are commanded even to honor the chair of Moses, and that although they who occupy it are accounted sinners. And now I have said enough to you, and I deem it superfluous to say to him how he is to live unblameably, since he is an approved disciple of him who taught me also. Chapter 71. Various duties of Christians. But, brethren, there are some things that you must not wait to hear, but must consider of yourselves what is reasonable. Zacchaeus alone having given himself up wholly to labor for you, and needing sustenance, and not being able to attend to his own affairs, how can he procure necessary support? Is it not reasonable that you are to take forethought for his living? Not waiting for his asking you, for this is the part of a beggar. But he will rather die of hunger than submit to do this. And shall not you incur punishment, not considering that the workman is worthy of his hire? And let no one say, is, then, the word sold which was freely given? Far be it. For if anyone has the means of living, and takes anything, he sells the word, but if he who has not takes support in order to live, as the Lord also took at supper and among his friends, having nothing, though he alone is the owner of all things, he sins not. Therefore suitably honor elders, catechists, useful deacons, widows who have lived well, orphans as children of the church. But wherever there is need of any provision for an emergency, contribute all together. Be kind one to another, not shrinking from the endurance of anything whatever for your own salvation. Chapter 72. Ordination. And having thus spoken, he placed his hand upon Zacchaeus, saying, O thou ruler and Lord of all, Father and God, do thou guard the shepherd with the flock. Thou art the cause, thou the power. We are that which is helped, thou the helper, the physician, the savior, the wall, the life, the hope, the refuge, the joy, the expectation, the rest. In a word, thou art all things to us. In order to the eternal attainment of salvation, do thou cooperate, preserve, protect. Thou canst do all things. For thou art the ruler of rulers, the Lord of lords, the governor of kings. Do thou give power to the president to loose what ought to be loosed, to bind what ought to be bound. Do thou make him wise. Do thou, as by his name, protect the church of thy Christ as a fair bride. For thine is eternal glory. Praise to the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost to all ages. Amen. Chapter 73. Baptisms. And having thus spoken, he afterwards said, Whoever of you wish to be baptized, begin from tomorrow to fast, and have hands laid upon you day by day, and inquire about what matters you please. For I mean still to remain with you 10 days. And after 3 days, having begun to baptize, he called me, and Aquila, and Nystus, and said to us, As I am going to set out for Tyre after 7 days, I wish you to go away this very day, and to lodge secretly with Bernice the Canaanite, the daughter of Justa, and to learn from her, and write accurately to me what Simon is about. For this is of great consequence to me, that I may prepare myself accordingly. Therefore depart straightway in peace. And leaving him baptizing, as he commanded, we preceded him to Tyre of Phoenicia.